The first session that I want to introduce is clinician performance measurement, the current landscape. So many believe that greater transparency and around patient outcomes is a critical step towards improving the quality and safety of patient care. And the growing use of technology, smartphones, the rapid and widespread use of the internet, and the development of websites that collect and report assessments and ratings of healthcare providers and hospitals has really changed, you know, the dynamics of today. And in addition to this, there are new laws, the ACA, the MACRA, which are laying the foundation for greater use of consumers to assess provider performance. So this is the theme of our symposium, performance measurement in healthcare. But what are the methods and factors to consider when developing clinician and hospital performance measures? Should these evaluations, whether we do them internally or externally done by outside sources, should they be made publicly available? What are the outcomes that matter? How are they assessed? Are patient ratings and surveys more important than patient outcomes? How do we involve patients in the process? So today for our first session, we're going to hear three important perspectives from people on the front line of these issues. Our first speaker is Ben Harder from US News and World Report. Ben is the chief of health analysis. I want you to be nice to Ben today. And he oversees the US News public reporting program, including best hospitals that we're all familiar with, or we think we're familiar with, best children's hospital, best nursing program. He's also a very well-recognized healthcare journalist, and he's written widely in many premier articles. And Ben will provide an overview of the physician level and hospital level public reporting of performance. Our second speaker, for many in the audience here, doesn't need any introduction. This is Dr. David Scher, who's the Senior Vice President of the Value Partnerships Division of Blue Cross Blue Shield of Michigan. David is responsible for running the Value Partnerships, and they have a wide range of programs that include the collaborative quality initiatives that that's what I work within, the Physician Group Incentive Program, Patient-Centered Medical Homes, and the Hospital Pay for Performance. He's been recognized as a healthcare hero recently by Crane's Detroit Business, and he's still a practicing MD. So when he speaks about this, he speaks from the heart of a clinician because he's still actively involved. He was the chair of the board of directors of the Michigan State Medical Society. David will provide his unique perspective on how Blue Cross Blue Shield of Michigan works with practitioners and physician organizations to improve health outcomes. Our third speaker is Ben Haywood. Ben is the co-founder and president of PatientsLikeMe. He founded it along with his brother in 2004, and this is probably the premier patient portal at the moment, with more than 430,000 patients registered, with detailing over 2,500 conditions. He's also the chief privacy officer for PatientsLikeMe, and currently PatientsLikeMe are forging collaborations with the FDA, with the National Quality Forum, and also the Robert Wood Jones Foundation, and we're going to hear more about that. So during the talks, we're going to let the speakers come one at each time. We're going to have at the end a panel discussion, and if you have questions during the talk, please write it down. We have mics in the audience during the panel discussion that will come to you, allow you to ask the questions to our speakers. But also, if you have questions, you can tweet them, and we have a Twitter wall, and during the panel discussion, we'll have moderated questions from Twitter as well. So we're hoping to engage both within here in this audience and also around the country and around the world. So I think that's it. So without further ado, I'm gonna introduce Ben Harder. Thank you, Ben.
Good morning. I'm really pleased to be here and appreciate all of you coming out to hear what I and the others will talk about. I want to thank Khurshid for the very nice introduction and for the invitation to come today, and also for the plea to be nice to me. I think you can read that as don't throw tomatoes if you disagree with what I'm about to say. I'd like to just achieve really two simple objectives today, but I do have a lot of material to cover, so I'm going to speak briefly. The first is, as promised, to give you a sense of the current landscape of public reporting with respect to doctor performance, doctor ratings. And the second is to give you an understanding of where U.S. News is within that landscape and where we're going. There are a couple of facts about U.S. News that are worth keeping in mind in that context. One is why we exist. We are a patient decision support publication. We've been in consumer service journalism for over 80 years as a publication. And what that means in the context of healthcare is that we want to provide patients and other decision makers with important information. We don't exist to help advance hospitals' self-promotional agendas. We don't exist to help payers and insurers decide where their networks, how their networks are constructed. We exist for patient decision support. The second is that we now have about 4 million people using our website every month specifically to look up a provider, a hospital, a doctor, a nursing home, some other healthcare provider. And that comes out to over 100,000 people a day. And because of the fact that most of those come during daytime hours, during the course of this panel, more than 10,000 people will use usnews.com to look up a doctor or look up a hospital. So we have a large, engaged patient audience. Right now, neither we nor I would argue anyone else in the public reporting space has the sort of information that most patients need and most patients are looking for. And I do want your help in figuring out how we can fix that. So this quote was a question that was directed to me 3 years ago in a slightly different context, but I think it's relevant today, and it's probably on all of your minds when I talk about things like doctor ratings. So I'll give you a little walk through where this came from. It was at a session that my U.S. News colleagues and I held 3 years ago to explain to three dozen or so hospital leaders what we were intending to do with hospital performance reporting. And specifically, we were engaging in a new undertaking that would evaluate hospitals in specific surgical procedures and conditions, very narrowly defined cohorts of patients. And we were going to be, for the first time, evaluating hospitals not only on the upside, those that were high performing, but also those that were low performing in our analysis. Furthermore, we were not going to be using reputation at all as a component of this project. And say what you might about reputation, it certainly adds some ballast, I guess, of face validity when clinicians weigh in on what they think the best hospitals are. So in this case, we were entirely at the mercy of our ability to analyze claims data and other publicly available data. And there was clearly some skepticism in my audience about whether we were going to be able to pull this off. This question, there were many, many very good, hard questions that day, including a number of them from Dr. Vinita Ball, who is one of the people present. But this question in particular from the CEO of a large academic medical center stumped me. I didn't have a good answer for it, and it took me at least two and a half years to realize what the answer was, and I'll share that with you toward the end of my remarks. How hard can rating doctors be, right? Well, we have lots of people who've done it. There's health grades, excuse me. Oh, we have Yelp. There's also the New York Magazine and the group Castle Connolly behind them. This one, I love this one, the top 10 urologists in the world. It's tougher to get on that rate MD's list than it is to score an invitation to the Last Supper. We have a checkbook. I'm not sure how many of you are familiar with their work. And then, of course, we have Surgeon Scorecard by ProPublica. So lots of organizations have attempted this, as you know, to remind you of the comment from the CEO. Others have tried and failed. What makes you think you'll succeed? Well, I thought I'd look up my moderator and see if Dr. Ghani was any good, because with all of these resources, it must be quite easy, right? And so Google directed me first to RateMDs, where I was pleased to discover that that Dr. Ghani is a 5-star urologist. And in fact, he's been ranked number 4 out of 51 in Ann Arbor. And that seemed pretty reassuring until I realized that there were exactly 2 reviews to his name. So I thought I'd check a little bit more, maybe add some more data to my data collection process here. I discovered this other website, Top Doctors, that's with a Z, and he was rated 0 stars, and that was a bit disconcerting until I realized they actually had no reviews on this website, and they had just presented that as a 0-star rating. The patient sort of patient review, online patient review process, I think, shifted into a new era last year with the introduction of two new public reporting efforts. One of them, I think, very familiar to you. I'm not sure how many of you are familiar with Consumer Checkbook and their website, surgeonratings.org. Okay, not too many, but a few. It's interesting. They actually released their results, I think, a month before ProPublica, but it's been almost entirely below the radar screen. They're a DC-based nonprofit, in fact. And then of course, there's ProPublica, and I don't need to belabor that, but I'll touch on a couple of points. Lots of ink has been spilled about ProPublica. One of the more definitive methodological critiques, and one of the first, was this paper by a Rand researcher and co-authors. And there were really five critiques that their work identified. Two of them in particular, the first, the reliability problem, and the last, potential misattribution of cases, I consider to be among the more intractable of the methodological challenges that they raised. And I think we can talk a little bit more about how US News and others potentially could address that going forward. This study, some of you in this room contributed to it, including Dr. Ghani and Dr. Offenberg, looked at the correlation, or looked for a correlation between the complications rate that was reported by the ProPublica group and performance measures that were available in the music registry. And unfortunately, looking at four different performance measures in the music registry, they found no significant correlations. And you can see the trend lines don't suggest much clinical significance either. So this is not reassuring when one looks at the correspondence of something that should be matching. You know, so there should be a good correlation there if they are truly measuring some underlying quality in a valid way. So if we consider that to be a sign of failure, it really does raise the question, is it possible to measure performance of surgeons with the data available to organizations like US News today? I think I'm going backward here, sorry. Despite the failures to date, I believe it is possible. And there are a couple of important attributes of the effort that will make it possible. One is what I'll call investigational humility. And that is that the investigators, and that in this case myself, I'm a journalist, not a health service researcher, but I employ HSRs and analysts, that we need to have a very healthy respect for the limitations of the data available to us, what they do and don't, or what they can and cannot expose about this underlying attribute of quality. And also a very strong mindfulness about the potential for unintended consequences of invalid or premature public reporting. The other thing that I have learned both through my work at US News and through witnessing the reaction to ProPublica's work is that ample communication with the clinical community and the research community is vital. And in fact, we had engaged in the three-year process that's led to our most recent release of the of our procedure and condition ratings at the hospital level. We had solicited input from dozens of clinicians, some of them working together as a medical advisory panel, some of them individuals who we reached out to critique our methods. And I think that work has been really vital to us, steering us away from some of the judgment errors we might have made, and steering us toward better opportunities. I want to share some of our data from the most recent publication of our hospital ratings. These are our tiering of hospitals into the three performance bands for CABG. We recognize high performing, low performing, average, and then low volume centers that we don't have enough information on to evaluate. And we compared this to the public STS ratings in CABG for the same centers. And what you would be most worried about is if there were a large number of frank discordances, hospitals that we said were good, that where STS said that their cardiac surgery program was poor. We did have one instance of this, but this was across almost 500 hospitals that we evaluated, that also have been evaluated by STS publicly in CABG. There are also some concern about hospitals that STS has identified as an outlier, either positive or negative, and US News has failed to identify as an outlier. And there were more cases of this. So there's no question that this is discordance and that we have to work that up and diagnose what's going on there. However, a much larger number of centers we agreed with STS entirely on, whether they were outliers or not outliers. And then there's a last category here of hospitals that STS did not identify as outliers and US News did. And you might consider those to be discordances. I don't think they are. I think it's really about our tolerance for a type 1 error and type 2 error. We set a much lower threshold for statistical confidence in calling outliers than STS does and then conventionally researchers do. And so we were able to discriminate a fair number of hospitals that STS had as 2 stars and that resolved into either a high-performing or low-performing band in our analysis. In addition, we were able to analyze all hospitals that had done any CABGs during the period of our analysis, even if they had not voluntarily publicly reported their STS results. And so we were able to identify hundreds of other programs and apportion them into our 3 performance bands. Lest you think that that was a fluke, we also published AVR ratings and compared those to STS's work, and we see a very similar pattern in terms of the small number of discordances and a large number of concordances or at least non-discordance. So what was different between the ProPublica work and the US News work in these 2 cases? Well, there are a few important differences. One, obviously, is the attribution level, and there's no question that's a big factor, surgeon versus hospital. Another is investigator and the process that we use to achieve our results. Also important differences are the service line and the setting of care where that service line, where that service is provided. And I think that there are some very important clues to how we need to approach surgeon rating in those 2 particular pieces. This is a study that just came out, I think a few weeks ago. It's in the October issue of Annals of Surgery. And what the researchers did is look at NISQIP data and compare that to the patient cohort definitions that ProPublica used. And you can see, I just extracted a few data points from one of their tables here, but that the vast majority of hip and knee surgeries were conducted in the inpatient setting, and so therefore were not excluded from the ProPublica analysis by virtue of the fact that ProPublica only used inpatient data. On the other hand, the majority of TURPs and radical prostatectomies were not going to be in the inpatient data that ProPublica used because they weren't conducted in that setting. And furthermore, there were some additional exclusions, non-emergent cases, in particular the fact that both ProPublica and US News are limited to Medicare fee-for-service patients. And so by the time you get through all of the exclusions that both ProPublica and at this point my analysts at US News need to grapple with, almost 42% of the knees had been excluded in the ProPublica analysis, but a whopping 96% of the lap cholecystectomies had been excluded. And that really raises some questions about the feasibility of examining at least the latter procedure using an inpatient Medicare fee-for-service data set. So as you can imagine, there is a good reason that I asked my team to look at the hospital level at knees and hips and have not asked them to look at lap cholecystectomies. That I thank many of the health service researchers and clinicians who've guided us along the way in steering us away from the areas of care that we might have been interested in, but that we simply weren't going to have enough data adequacy to evaluate. So, when it comes to surgeon ratings and physician performance measurement, US News will undertake to look at hip surgeons and knee surgeons first. We know that we have the majority of cases in the inpatient context. We know that we have the majority of cases in the Medicare fee-for-service population, and we have, therefore, the material to work with, we believe, to get at performance measurement and differences. What we will, what we're intending to do here is wait until we have had an opportunity to analyze outpatient data from Medicare before we pursue or even contemplate a performance measurement in a number of other specialties and subspecialties. And I think that that's an important, the sequencing of these analyses is going to be very important for us. So those of you who are urologists in the room, you're off the hook for at least a little while because we've got to do what we can with the inpatient data first. Our objective in publishing also is going to be a little bit different than ProPublica's. Their stated goal was to provide advice for patients, but I think there was a bit of accountability, at least an undertone of accountability in their work. Again, our purpose is to provide decision support, and so we're going to take some different approaches analytically to achieve that. One of the things that we want to do is identify hopefully a tranche of surgeons who have reassuring safety results, reasonably high volume, so we can be fairly confident of their results, and have other quality indicators associated with them that are reassuring. Therefore, we can, with a fairly unqualified approach, recommend those surgeons. We are not nearly as interested in identifying low-performing surgeons, and we think that there are some real limitations in the data that would make that an incredible challenge. What we are not planning to do, I will add, is to try to identify the top 10 urologists in the world. Though this guy on the right seems really nice, I'm sure he's got great bedside manner. Now, I'll just touch briefly on the measures that we're looking at and our risk adjustment. We can come back to this during the discussion if you want. We do think volume is an important quality indicator. We are looking at length of stay, readmissions, infections, not using NHSN data, which we found to be very problematic, but claims-based measures that were developed by researchers, most of them in Boston. Mortality, even though obviously in hip and knee and many other surgeries incredibly rare, doesn't provide much signal, but it does add some additional information. And then revision surgeries, though there are some challenges with that as well. There is a CMS-defined measure that we will also be using at the surgeon level. Our risk adjustment approach is fairly standard here. The one thing I will point out, because it differs from CMS's approach, is that we are attempting to adjust for socioeconomic status. And all of this is how we do hospital level risk adjustment right now, so we're going to be porting that over to the surgeon level performance. These C statistics are pulled straight from our methodology report, which I tweeted out a few minutes ago. So if you're interested in checking at Ben Harder, you'll be able to find these and for other procedures what our C statistics are. Nothing to brag about. I know that we would all like to see readmissions, among others, higher than this, but these are certainly comparable to what any other claims-based effort has produced. And approaches some clinical-based risk adjustment models. We're going to look at additional indicators, and one of those will be hospital quality. One thing that ProPublica decided to do, they made a judgment that they would pull out hospital effect. We think that's really important to keep in, and obviously it is, you know, I think one of the things, I'm sure we'll talk about this during the discussion, but the one of the pitfalls of public reporting at the surgeon level is that it seems to mask all of the important teamwork that goes on in the surgical center or hospital context. That is not our intention. What our intention is to help patients pick their surgeon, because that's ultimately the provider they interact with. They don't have a choice in their anesthesiologist or their critical care team or their nurse staffing. But the hospital quality will help us get at that. We're also interested in looking at training and educational quality, and there's been some interesting research done by David Ash and colleagues at the University of Pennsylvania on how to use outcomes to assess the quality of the training a physician has received. I won't talk about patient-reported outcomes, though they're vitally important, but I know other speakers will speak to that. We're interested in patient experience, and the University of Utah, we'll hear from that perspective, has obviously started a trend. We see more and more hospitals now voluntarily putting physician-level information online, and we think that that may be useful in our efforts in the future. And then clinical registries, which I think have really seen a sea change in how they think about their work, being not just for quality improvement, but also potentially for patient decision support. Research on surgeon specialization has caught our attention, and we will be looking at whether that can add additional signal to our models. And then low-value care, which will be particularly important for some surgical specialties where some providers may be providing more than they need to. This study came out in New England Journal last year looking at cataract surgery, and I think that there will be other examples we can look at in different areas of surgical care. So coming back to the more intractable, the challenges that the critics of the ProPublica work have identified, there is the small sample size problem and reliability challenges, and there's the challenge of misattribution of cases. For those of you who aren't familiar with it, there were some primary care doctors or hospitalists who were identified as surgeons in their analysis, and it obviously had to do with the coding of the Medicare Part A claims. So there are these two challenges. We have a couple of ways of attacking this. One is that we know outcome measures are noisy and unreliable. They're noisy and sometimes unreliable at the hospital level, and they're going to be even noisier at the surgeon level. Our approach to this in our hospital analysis and the analysis we use for surgeons is to use latent variable modeling. We believe quality to be an underlying unobservable measure, and every directionally correct measure that we can add into our model will help us better ascertain what that underlying measure is. So some researchers have looked at our results for the procedure and condition ratings that we published last month and been disappointed by the relatively low weight we assign to outcome measures, but that has to do with their low reliability. These, in fact, are the model fit statistics that we published in our methodology report for that hospital's analysis, and these are all relatively reassuring statistics. The other challenge is attribution. How often does a claim identify the wrong physician, the wrong NPI associated with a surgical case? Well, we think that's a great research question, and we think that there are a number of registries that could be attacking this. I've tried to do a literature review. I've found no study that has addressed that question other than one done by CMS, which used Part A and Part B claims and compared the concordance of the NPI. But we think that there are a lot of opportunities for clinical registries to explore this either on their own or in collaboration with US News, and we've already approached some registries about this idea. So coming back to the original question, what makes me think we can succeed? Well, I think the lessons that I've learned over the course of the journey we've had on hospital quality measurement is that we can't do it without researchers and clinicians like you telling us where we're going wrong, telling us where the opportunities to identify new measures and to get at a better measure of quality where it lies. And so I think the answer that I've come to 3 years after this hospital CEO asked me the question is that we will do it because we will get help from folks like you. So I want to thank you for your time and attention this morning and turn it over to my co-panelists. Thank you.
Thank you, Ben. So you'll have questions for Ben. Write them down. We'll be discussing this in the panel discussion, or tweet them, but put the hashtag as HSR16. And now, Dr. David Scher is our second speaker. Thank you.
Good morning. For a moment there, I was beginning to feel like Orestes and the Flies with the lawnmower behind us. I think that's the modern day version of the flies. We're not plagued by flies so much, but certainly by snow blowers and lawnmowers and leaf blowers. But that's not the subject of my talk. And neither is it really a focus in detail on performance measurement per se, although I appreciate the sophistication and rigor that Ben described in the work that they're doing, and that's very encouraging to see that a high-profile publication like that is approaching the challenge in that way. I've been asked to speak to an insurer's or about an insurer's perspective on performance measurement, and I interpreted that a little bit flexibly because I do work for an insurance company, and I am going to give you my perspective, but I can't honestly say that this is an insurer's perspective. And I'm going to not actually focus much at all on the technical details, but more on the sense of purpose and long-term vision that I think is important to bring to this challenge. And hopefully by the end of my remarks, you'll have a sense of what I'm trying to get at. But Khurshid asked me just to set the stage by explaining the role that I play. So I'm Senior Vice President of Value Partnerships, as he mentioned. And we have two areas of work in my 50-person area. And we have another 50 people in a partner analytic area at Blue Cross Blue Shield of Michigan. And half of the work is focused on the Physician Group Incentive Program, which is fundamentally focused on creating systemness in the state of Michigan in healthcare from a state of fragmentation and lack of systemness, partnering with providers across the state to integrate practice information systems, care management processes, and so forth, and performance measurement and monitoring and accountability across settings, across PCP, specialist, hospital, and other settings. And then the other half of the work, and that's what I'll focus on more, is the collaborative quality initiatives. You'll be hearing much more about that over the next day and a half. So I'm not going to talk in detail about it. We do have slides, yeah. So, and I'm also not going to use slides. I find that when I speak from slides, I fall asleep, so I fear what will happen to you. There is a set of slides available, I think, out at the desk where you registered in case you want them, and I can provide them to you electronically. But and there's a lot of detail on the mechanics of the collaborative quality initiatives. But I think it's more important to focus on a higher level set of understandings of the purpose of them. So that's what I propose to do. So first, to achieve something meaningful in healthcare, in my view, requires operating from a sense of purpose and vision, having great clarity about that. And while it's important to measure performance, and it's important to publicly report information, and I get that, if all you're doing is focusing on MIPS and MACRA and mortality and HEDIS and QRS and STARS, and that's probably the kind of alphabet soup that you expected me to talk about and that I'm intentionally not going to focus on today. And I grant that you have to master all of that, and as David said, importantly, because you're going to be accountable for all that as providers and as researchers, because payment will be tied to it. But if that's all you do, if your nose is to the grindstone and you're focusing narrowly on the specific metrics, I think you'll miss the big picture, and I think without the big picture, you'll miss the mark. I don't think A1C rates or mortality rates in procedures where mortality is very, very uncommon are what are important to patients. And I'll get to, by the end of the talk, I hope, a sense of what I think may be, at least in part, if not exclusively. So in order to have vision and purpose, you have to have leadership, and not just take it for granted. Well, we're all doctors or researchers, and so, of course, you know, by all doing something that is compelling to us, you add it all up, it'll come out to something good. I don't think that's enough. I think that it's important to be explicit and intentional about your purpose and to intentionally lead. And to do that, you have to engage the hearts and minds of the people who are doing the work, the people at the front lines. They have to feel this sense of purpose. And I think in the upcoming sessions that will include more specifics about particular collaborative quality initiatives, and the reason I've left this slide up here is because you'll see it represents the span of focus of the CQI programs across the state of Michigan and how much of care these programs are touching, then I think you'll begin to grasp the ways in which the leaders of the CQIs are intentionally engaging the rank and file, especially providers doing very technical, complex work with high cost and high risk, and engaging them in efforts to continuously self-assess and self-improve their care, and to do it in a collaborative way. The intention then is to empower communities of physicians and their team members to continuously and rigorously self-examine, harnessing the workings of comparative effectiveness research on almost a daily basis in their efforts to do so. These are not standalone, one-off projects that are tied to registries that happen to do some good. But the intent is to actually transform the culture in the state of Michigan in healthcare to one in which the provider community is fully in harness in terms of intrinsic motivation to self-assess and improve, and enabled to do so through the technical resources that the CQI programs bring to bear on their their challenges, and through the community of collaborating providers who come together to harness those resources. And when folks outside of the state of Michigan look at this, and I think if you ask any CQI leader, they will echo this, invariably people say, how did that happen? How did you get people to come together to collaborate? How did you get a Blue Cross plan to support you in doing so? We couldn't do that. And I'll assert that when we started this journey in 1996, we couldn't do that either until we decided that we could. And so that's, again, getting back to this notion of leadership. Henry Ford made this statement a long time ago that whether you think you can or you think you can't do a thing, you're right. And I'll assert that in Michigan, we have believed we could, and we did, and it's been a compelling and impactful adventure. So, replication doesn't come easy, and while you can see we've replicated this across the state in Michigan, getting it to be exported and to take root elsewhere has been very difficult because this belief that the competition is what drives healthcare, not collaboration, and I would assert that that doesn't really get us very far, and I'll give some specific examples of why that is. But we are beginning to see in Pennsylvania, California, Tennessee, and other states, specific CQI programs are now being replicated, and it's energizing the communities in these other locales. And so I'm hopeful that this is not just a one-off Michigan thing that will be viewed as a delightful curiosity, but I really do hope that it will transform practice well outside of the boundaries of our state. So another important concept that undergirds our thinking and animates us is reflected in an idea that Ben Franklin articulated. And his line is, tell me and I forget, teach me and I may remember, involve me and I learn. And so if you have an external entity pointing the finger at doctors saying, here are the QRS stars, HEDIS measures, here's the U.S. News and report on your performance, get to it, that has a certain motivation, especially when there's money or referrals tied to it. But if you actually involve providers who are professionally motivated from the outset to own the workings of assessing themselves and improving themselves and proving themselves as competent and capable, the degree of engagement, the professional pride that drives them is stunning. So said another way, tell people what to do using extrinsic motivation, and they do the least necessary to get the doggy biscuit. But if you you inspire people through harnessing intrinsic motivation, they do the most possible. So for example, with the first CQI, which started in 1997, and this is the BMC squared peripheral vascular intervention collaborative, 6 to 8 hospitals came together doubting that they should trust the university, because of course the university just wants their data for publications. They certainly didn't trust Blue Cross because Blue Cross had some nefarious plan. But they did come together and they were convinced that the data were for measurement to improve, not measurement to judge. And when they came together, one of the first learnings was that by pooling data, they discovered that the variation across centers was much greater than the variation within a center. So by collaborating and pooling data, the grist for the mill of that variation was what led them to new understandings of what worked and what didn't. And if they had just been left to their own devices in their own center, where there was little variation, they would have relatively little to learn. They'd have no perspective on how their practice fared compared to others. And so one of the first things they discovered was that while nephropathy requiring dialysis was an uncommon complication, and sure, the substrate wasn't good, and older people with vascular disease were more at risk for kidney damage, so what could you do was kind of the attitude. They discovered that there were certain risk factors in the patients and certain processes of care for which there was variation in how the practice community across these centers behaved, and there was variation in outcomes. And they actually discovered the secret sauce for what they could do in the cath lab, before the cath lab, and after the catheterization experience to mitigate the risk of complications. They decreased, within 4 years, they decreased the risk of nephropathy requiring dialysis by 60%. That led to a reduction in mortality for coronary angioplasty of 25%. That saved a ton of money. And none of that was known. It was by collaborating and pooling data and self-assessing that they were able to achieve that. They've gone on to address vascular complications and transfusions and the almost previously untouchable subject of appropriateness. So that so think about every single angioplasty program in the state of Michigan coming together to share their data openly with one another, to talk about what works and what doesn't, and to begin to talk about when and whether a procedure should be done at all. It truly is stunning. You'll see other examples today, and I believe tomorrow also, of this being played out again and again and again in other contexts. So why is this so? What is it that gets people so energized? There is a large body of research on what motivates people outside of healthcare, even in conservative arenas like the world of finance, and to distill it into the most elemental aspects of what does motivate people. It's three things. It's a sense of purpose, getting back to that idea of vision and clarity of purpose. It is an experience of autonomy, having the latitude to feel like you are able to be an actor in the world in your profession. And it's a sense of mastery, being proud that you can do work that is of high quality, high caliber, you're competent. And those three things are what get people up, you know, in the morning and get them excited about their work and get them willing to come together and talk about their strengths and their weaknesses for the purpose of doing better. And for physicians, what really motivates them more than anything after they make a decent living is not making a ton of money. It's not outperforming their peers. It's feeling that sense of purpose, autonomy, and mastery. So a close cousin of that is curiosity. We're highly motivated to learn. I forgot to mention, I wanted to introduce myself. I'm a PGY40. And the reason I say that is because I think all of us, if we take the profession seriously, are in the mode of being continuous learners. There's no end to that, and there shouldn't be. I see that I'm talking longer. These are my introductory remarks than I intended, so I'm going to skip some of the things that I wanted to say. But another key insight about the CQI programs is that more can be accomplished by collaboration than by competition. And I've already actually given you an example of that in PCI, in that when a complication occurs infrequently, the number of observations you can make within your own practice or your own institution are, by nature, small, right? And so your ability to actually correlate processes and outcomes within a risk-adjusted manner that is robust statistically is really compromised. But when you pool data, you set aside your competitive interests and pool data, you can achieve much more. So not only do you get statistical rigor, but as I mentioned earlier, you begin to see the variation in practice that helps you to grasp more clearly which practices work and add value, which practices don't and can be dispensed with, which practices are dangerous and should be avoided at all costs. And importantly, when you think about competition versus collaboration, with competition, you wind up trying to identify who are the best. And health plans try to shoehorn that the best, the top 25%, into a narrow network and then sell that for competitive advantage in the marketplace. But 80% of the patients in the community can't fit into the provider capacity of 25% of the providers. And so it's just, it actually is an equation that can't be solved. In my view, it's antisocial. And the real goal, and again, a sense of vision and purpose and intentionality, should be to enable all providers, all hospitals, if we're talking about hospital-based care, with the ability to harness comparative effectiveness research and collaborative practice improvement to be self-assessing and self-optimizing so that the level of care and the level of outcomes is raised across the board. But this takes a leap of faith, and a leap of faith in the sense of, I'll give you a conceptual way of looking at it. Are any of you familiar with the prisoner's dilemma? A few. So it's pretty simple, although when you start thinking about it, it quickly gets complicated. But basically, the premise is prisoners are more likely to be able to escape if they collaborate than if they are working only for themselves. But collaboration requires trust, that leap of faith. And if they make that leap, but they don't all then join in good faith because one thinks he or she is going to get the advantage, then they all are more likely to fail. And so it requires a fundamental commitment on the part of all the individuals and the individual institutions. But more importantly, I like to think of it as requiring a transformation of culture, how we think about ourselves in an institution, in a community of professionals, in service to a community of patients. And so I think one of the greatest gifts that the CQI program has given to the state of Michigan is that I believe we have in fact transformed our culture. When we first started, I described the level of distrust that existed. Now, when the next subject comes up as an opportunity for people to come together, area of care, to apply the CQI model, people aren't asking whether they should trust. They're saying, how quickly can I get in? Because people across the state are very aware of this powerful model. I think I've made many of these comments. All right, so while we're all individually curious, whatever PGY year we're in, there's another aspect of the phenomenon of the CQIs I'd like to make explicit, which is that by harnessing comparative effectiveness research in this very intentional and organized way, and importantly, this isn't just about pooling data, generating reports, and going back to your lair to examine them privately. It's about working in concert with others in the context of very positive and very active professional relationships, coming together in an organized way regularly, usually every 3 or 4 months, to examine the data and to talk the nuance about the challenges that you face in the clinical arena. What we have done is create what many people are starting to call learning health systems. And I think it's really a fair way to characterize the CQI model. And so getting back to this notion of having a sense of vision and purpose, when we first envisioned the BMC squared PCI collaborative, although it was inspired by similar work that was first done in northern New England, and so we understood that this could work, the other thing that we were very aware of was that this isn't just something for cardiology or for cardiac surgery, which is the only place it had been tested, but really it was about an opportunity to transform the way that doctors and their colleagues, their teams, come together to self-optimize, and that it could actually become a model for doing just that. So I think that given that we have, the slides are gone. It was a good slide. That was the table with that list. Given that we've done this all across the state, think of that as a set of learning health systems that are now at a meta level beginning to learn from one another, because we bring the leaders of the CQIs together also about every 3 months, and they to compare notes, to rub shoulders, to self-examine how they do this work and how they could do it better, so that we actually have this highly intentional culture that's not just, again, a set of separate projects, but is it's an effort to try to learn to do better the challenge of self-assessment and self-improvement. And if you contrast that to HEDIS and QRS and stars, if you're familiar with those kind of metrics. I think if you ask patients what is really important to them, it doesn't tend to be the A1C level or the rate of of retinal exams for diabetes. Not that these things aren't clinically important, not that doctors and nurses and patients shouldn't be focusing on them. And of course they're interested in mortality rates, but if the truth is the mortality rate for the procedure they're gonna get is 0.9%, and if they're pretty healthy and unlikely to have that problem, they're unlikely to have that problem anywhere. So maybe what's more important to a patient, in part, not in whole, is to know that the provider is actually not just doing the same thing over and over again that he was trained to do 30 years before, but that he or she is actively involved in a learning health system that reliably, continuously delivers high-level, high-value outcomes and improves them day over day. And the last point I'll make is that in our work in the ambulatory practice world, we're intentionally focused on collaborations between primary care and specialty care in coordinating care and being accountable for the outcomes of that care, but with the intention that that be done in active partnership with the patient. So if you're familiar with the patient-centered medical home model, one of the basic precepts that we've called out in Michigan as being most vital and most foundational is a patient-provider agreement, the sense that the patient is a full partner in the relationship, and it calling out in very explicit detail what that means. What are the opportunities and the obligations or responsibilities of the patient and of the doctor and the practice team in that relationship? And in that context, oftentimes the question when you ask about the patient's voice, what matters to the patient, and let me tell you about my mortality rate, that's not the focus. The question becomes, what's most important to you as a patient? And oftentimes, it's almost always more in human terms. I want to live until my daughter gets married. I want to be able to walk my granddaughter around the block. And then when you start talking about healthcare and what healthcare can do to help the patient achieve his or her goals, it becomes much more meaningful and the intrinsic motivation of the patient is elevated substantially. By analogy, the work that the CQI leaders and participants are doing increasingly is beginning to bring the voice of the patient into the discussion to enrich the research-oriented practice of the CQI model with a deeper understanding of what really matters to patients, so that I hope ultimately we will be able to expand this learning health system notion beyond just the professional-centric approach to incorporate much more of what matters to patients. And then I hope that, Ben, that you and your work are as sophisticated as the work that you're describing is and as important as it is, begins to, at some point in time, when you've mastered this, which I'm sure is going to happen very quickly, begins to incorporate the voice of the patient in more human terms as you go forward. And I look forward to hearing the comments of the next Ben, I feel outnumbered, who will be talking more specifically about the voice of the patient, and I thank you for your attention.
Thank you, David. I know your comments have already raised lots of questions on Twitter, so our next speaker is Ben Haywood from PatientsLikeMe.
Hi, thank you guys for having me. It's an honor to speak with you today. I think oftentimes I'm invited to these because now for something a little different. Just to give you a little sense of my background, my dad's an MIT professor. He's actually the leading internal combustion engine specialist in the world. I read The Machine That Changed the World, probably when I was in my young teens. So lean manufacturing, which is something that we don't talk a lot about in healthcare, is sort of baked into my bones. I'm a manufacturing engineer by training. And we talk about one of the powers of lean is, to echo some of the things Dr. Scher talked about, is enabling the line workers in manufacturing to help and be involved in the problem solving and design and fixing of really complicated manufacturing processes around making cars. And I think we shouldn't forget that as we proceed. And I'll talk, I do hope to talk a little bit about some of the emerging work that we're doing and general across the board around bringing the patient voice into some of these things. So you'll hear a little bit different language, but I'm going to talk about a lot of the same things, but hopefully a little bit more in the patient voice. So this is an academic conference. I do work for a for-profit company, so I guess one of my biases that I want to disclose is this. My goal is to create this. Our company's goal is to create this, and I actually think all of healthcare's goal should be to create this, because I think that's truly when we'll have a marketplace for healthcare that's working. But one of the challenges we have as a system, and you guys know the various parts of this, is that we have a $3 trillion healthcare economy that really only maybe affects this clinical care environment about 20% of outcomes. And I think we need to begin to think about the whole patient as we begin to solve these problems. And Dr. Sher talked about moving to sort of including the patients in these learning healthcare systems. I think integrally, the whole patient is what fundamentally matters. And I think that needs to be more of a starting point, not a next step. So some of the key questions I'll talk about, I think, as you go to this avenue that I think are important. How much awareness do patients have about clinical performance metrics? I think what Ben talked about is some of the things they're doing well to get this out to patients and consumers. What might patients demand where their greater transparency? Dr. Ghani asked the question, should we be transparent in sharing these measures with the public? I find it interesting that we're still asking that question. We work with Robert Wood Johnson. They did a great project around open notes 5 years ago, which is gaining momentum. It still flabbergasts me that we had to run a test to determine whether sharing doctor's notes with patients would actually improve care, but it did, and it's an important thing. So transparency, I think, is ultimately key. How can patients contribute to greater understanding of quality clinical care and performance? So how do we think about, if we begin to bring them into this process, what fundamentally will change? How will we think about it differently? Can we do this differently? And then lastly, I think, what would it mean fundamentally to include patients deeply in this process of performance measure development? So, look, we started 12 years ago. I'll talk a little bit about Patients Like Me, but we started working with our communities of patients to measure with patient-reported outcomes and patient-generated data 12 years ago in our open communities. There's been an amazing evolution and progression of the science in the last 12 years. One of the people we work with had a great expression, which is, how do you raise the voice to the patient voice to the level of medical evidence and what's involved in that process? And I think that's one of the journeys we've been on. Obviously patient input was, even when we started, although it's still today in some environments, largely non-essential, although obviously more and more, that's been rapidly changing. I think the gap is narrowing between the emerging science around patient voice and patient reported and patient generated data. And then what does that mean ultimately for performance measures? And I'll talk a little bit about the gap between those two. I mean, you guys probably know most of this. I won't belabor these definitions, but I think a few points I want to make here is, so we have been taking patient reported outcome measures to patients directly to enable them in their own care and enable their physicians and clinicians to work better with them for 12 years. Interestingly, I came to the performance measure space last year when we got a Robert Wood Johnson grant to work with NQF, and I'll talk a little bit about that, around patient-reported performance measures. And I will say, as someone who has thought a lot about patient-reported outcomes deeply, in the hands of patients and the system, performance measures is a very hard concept to understand. I'm a decently smart guy. I've been working in this space, and conceptually, it's a fundamentally different thing than PROs themselves. And I think that's a challenge as we think about including patients in this process and what that means. But it's something just to keep in mind. I think there's a few other things around this I think are important as we think about the evidence generation. I think Ben knows this better as an organization than many, is that we talk a lot about the evidence generation, the generation of these performance measures to improve care. What we don't talk about is how that evidence is actually utilized in the science of understanding that. And, you know, ultimately, medical evidence, whether it's outcomes or performance measures, are ultimately consumed by the patient, whether that's because they listen to their doctor or the system that they're working with, or they're making a decision autonomously on their own. And we don't really understand that. And you know, if you look at something like consumer, if you think about your own experience when you're buying a car and you use consumer reports and you really research it deeply and you say, I'm gonna get a Honda Accord, and then the night before you go to buy it at a cocktail party, someone tells you an anecdote about Honda Accord not being good and it screws up your whole system. Well, that's an important thing to think about as we think about medical evidence as well, because ultimately it is consumed by the patient, and we need to understand that and engage them in that process more effectively so they can become smarter and smarter consumers. So again, I think one of the things that's key as we go on this journey and really integrate the patient voice into the performance measure process is owning this concept. Something about the New Yorker cartoons that really can encapsulate great concepts very simply. But I think fundamentally, if you in your heart of hearts don't own the concept that the patient in front of you and patients in general are the experts in their disease, I think that needs to be the starting point in all of this work. I'm just go back here for 1 second. Couple other things to just talk about as we go. You know, those of you who have worked in PR, PROM development, patient reported outcome measure development, I mean, obviously what's been interesting is that there's been 30 or plus years of really rigorous science around upgrading the methodology and taking that to a methodology for getting objectively measuring the patient experience. You know, one of the really great things that PROs do is they force information symmetry. So patients and doctors can look at PRO data and they have their own interpretation of that meaning, and that creates a dialogue and it forces information symmetry in the system. And I think that's a very important thing. And so even if you go outside of PROs and just thinking about performance measures in general, I think thinking about how to include patients in that and force that information symmetry so patients and clinicians are working on the same page is a very valuable thing. I will say one of the other shocking things as I've gone into the performance measure space after being sort of in the PRO space for a long time is actually the lack of understanding of the methodology and the science around PRO development. I was talking with one of the major measure developers in the system, and they were working on a new measure. And I was saying, well, how are you getting patients involved? And they said, oh, well, our process has a patient on the, you know, the expert panel, and there's a patient expert. They may or may not have the disease, but they'll be there. And you know, I'm thinking, okay, you have 8 clinicians and 1 patient that may or may not have your condition. Probably not the best way to actually get patient input. And I was surprised at just while there's incredible richness in some of the method in a lot of the performance measurement space about maintaining measures and continuously making sure they're meaningful and relevant, I was a little bit surprised at how little they've taken from the PRO space. So obviously, you know, I'm here, I think, generally because this is true, the missing voice of the patient. You know, Dr. Scher really talked about it, how that now that they've built up these learning health systems, one of the next really big initiatives for them is to include the patient voice much more actively, because I think that's ultimately what a learning health system needs to be. It's also finding its way broadly in a lot of the places in that are driving policy. And again, I think that's, as someone eloquently put to start, that's why we're probably all here talking about this. It's because it's being pushed from the federal level. I think these are NQS standard buckets of measures. I think most of the measures in the system are around process. I think we need to both move a lot more to outcomes and then understand that linkage between process and outcomes. And then we also have to think about new and other ways of thinking about this problem and really push these boundaries. You know, again, the patient voice has always been there in healthcare, right? I mean, on some level, I like to think of doctors as excellent sensors for patient experience. The best doctors, one of the things they do, or clinicians, one of the things they do, is they capture the patient experience in the interview, and that's captured in the system through the doctor. So that's always been there. It's just got into the system in various ways. Not really captured all that well for studying, but definitely there. You know, obviously, the MACRA legislation that is coming out really is pushing this even further. These 8 or 9 bullet points are straight from that plan, and just highlighting these things here, pushing, integrating the voice, using crowdsourcing, which is a little warms my heart, and then outcome measures, including PROMs, much more focused around that. But you know, as you think about this, and you think about this on the internet, you know, the sources of data we generate are exploding all over the place, and you know, here we are trying to manage and think about hospital improvement and performance measure and healthcare broadly, and how do we think about all of these millions and of sources of data exploding. I think one of the things we should be focusing on is, going back to that sensor thing, is imagine what we could learn if we align the patient experience with the data that patients generate. So I love this, you know, this comic really captures it well, but you know, that's all data that could be captured very easily in both patient-reported data as well as patient-generated data. And I think we're going to see a new world very quickly here where this stuff is flowing into the system. And we know in our work with hospital systems and the healthcare system broadly that they're really trying to think and understand how that can be utilized. But obviously, you know, we have a lot of work to do. I mean, I think Ben talked about some of the work and some of the challenges. I think this is some of the challenges around patient-generated health data. you know, we as an organization have spent a lot of time trying to think about how to share what we've learned in the 12 years. I think it's important that we begin to bring these expertises together. Again, this mashup of PROs and performance measures. There's a number of projects. There's the work we're doing with NQF and Robert Johnson. Ethan Bosch down in North Carolina is doing a great PCORI project around pro-PMs in cancer. And this, there's some real powerful opportunities to get there. Again, there's a lot of emerging literature and stuff. So just to talk a little bit about me and patients like me, why am I here? If you don't know our story, I'm the youngest of 3 brothers. I lost my middle brothers to Lou Gehrig's disease in 2006. But when he was diagnosed in 1999, our family did 2 things. We actually started a nonprofit biotech that does hardcore in vivo drug discovery in ALS. Studies it in the SOD1 mouse model. To give you a sense of scale, that lab's run about 30,000 SOD1 mice through it in the last 15 years, so huge industrial level science. One of the things Jamie did, who founded that institute, is he tried to replicate all of the studies that had been published with known drug effect in the mice and failed drug effect in humans. And he couldn't replicate it, and basically he took his control database of mice, ran Monte Carlo simulations simulating all of those studies, and basically found that 90%+ of the published drug effects in the literature of SOD1 mice in ALS were in the noise floor of unaccounted phenotype. So, you know, not matching litters, not matching dropouts, just size and scale of studies and to your small n problem. And I think one of the things we started 5 years later is to start patients like me to really measure and understand that patient phenotype and then bring patients into that process. And again, to push the boundaries of your thinking about what's possible in terms of including patients in the process of science or in the process of performance measures, Jamie's lab in 2001 streamed the animal LIMS system live to the web so patients could see the results blinded of the drug studies in real time. And then he had monthly conference calls with those patients to talk about the science. So, you know, you really don't underestimate what's possible when you begin to include patients in that process. As you mentioned, 450,000 plus patients, registered patients in the system across a lot of different conditions. We have a real strong strength in a number of conditions from MS to ALS to Parkinson's, fibromyalgia, depression. What patients do is they come together in our system and they share structured patient-reported outcome measures, symptoms, treatments, self-reported labs, although more and more we're integrating into the clinical data, as well as actually beginning to measure the biology. We do a number of things. I'll talk about some of these other initiatives here. So Look, we've been measuring with patients for 12 years. We started with actually a PRO in ALS. It's the ALS functional rating scale, ALS-FRS, as it's so catchily named. And what's interesting about that scale is it's got a lot of power. It's meaningful to patients, directly meaningful to patients. It actually maps to the pathology really well. It's actually the primary endpoints in trials for drugs for ALS and utilized in clinical care. So that PRO kind of hit, we didn't know it at the time, but that PRO hit that trifecta of being meaningful to patients, being useful in trials and useful in care, and it's actually a very powerful thing to when you begin to integrate all those together. But some of the things we've learned, and again, most PROs historically have been designed for research and not for use in care or not for use for an individual patient. And so we when we look at PROs either that exist or we develop our own in-house with our research team, you know, these are some of the things that we really look at, and I think this is key as we move into the both design principles and measurement principles as we begin to include patients in this process of performance measures. So just a couple of studies we've done on the platform. So patients are sharing this data in the system. We do database analysis on the system. We also do prospective studies with our communities. This is a great story we did with working with AAN when they were publishing the new guidelines in epilepsy. Their guidelines are very straightforward, 9-point thing where it's like, did you ask about driving, side effect management, you know, pregnancy, very simple things, and everyone assumed that the guidelines were almost not useful in the context of, you know, actually improving care, because it was assumed that everyone, that it was just being done because it was so basic. What we found is simultaneously with the release, we went out to our epilepsy community, and one thing we discovered is a lot of patients aren't seeing epileptologists or even neurologists for their seizure disorder. And so we found much better compliance to the measure for the specialists, and then as you went down, less and less compliance with obviously a much larger error bar or variation. Similarly, we went into an environment that we thought to study whether or not our platform could improve self-efficacy and self-management. Again, if you engage patients in the measurement and understanding of their disease, what happens? We actually thought we'd get mostly Iraq and Afghan veterans. We didn't. We got mostly 60-plus-year-old men, which is probably one of the harder populations for us to reach. But we were able to show, just by engaging on the platform with no additional, you know, engagement or activation measures, that we were able to move the needle on some percentage in a statistically meaningful way, published in Neurology last year. And then also, you know, again, stuff we just don't capture that well, off-label use. We have thousands upon thousands of data points on patients using drugs off-label, with obviously in concert with their physician. And even when at a minimum, it's understanding other uses of drugs. The other perspective is understanding whether or not your patient truly understands why you prescribed and what you prescribed the drug for. I think both are meaningful. And we have a FDA partnership in which we're looking at some of this data. We're working with their surveillance. Office of Surveillance and Epidemiology, which is sort of looks at drug safety, and we're working with them to understand patient-generated health data. And just to give you a sense of how strong this is, I mean, I know this is on the care side, but on the discovery side with the FDA, they've been resistant to real-world evidence. They've been resistant to database and outcome studies based on claims data. And now that Sentinel, which is a some of you guys might be involved in various ways, or your institutions might be, has gone into the FDA, which is basically a giant surveillance system utilizing claims and observational data. And clinical data, there's a much more openness to real-world data, and they're really exploring and trying to understand patient-generated health data and what that means. I touched on this a few times. We're also working with the NQF in a grant funded by Robert Wood Johnson to look at developing PROPMs and what we can do to bring patients in. We have a platform called the Open Research Exchange, which is basically a patient-reported outcome measure platform for. That sort of takes open source software concepts and applies it to measure development. We're utilizing that to bring patients into this process. So looking at performance measures, how do we elicit relevant concepts? How do patients define good care? We just did a large survey, a couple hundred patients across multiple things, where we got about 2,600 concepts, statements that around good care that we're now refining down to a smaller sort of gold set that we're going to have the patients themselves concept mapped. And actually, we're going to have a number of experts that we had interviewed previously concept mapped as well. And we're going to look at some of the difference between those concept mapping of the by the patients of those statements and the experts in the field. And obviously, this will all be shared and published as we go. I think the two other things are very interesting that we want to look at. What does a shared framework of accountability look like? So, you know, if patients knew that you were or were not getting paid based on actions they did, what's their take on that? How do we think about that problem? I know that's a huge problem for patient-reported outcomes and performance measures in general with physicians, but let's just begin to ask patients about that. And then lastly, I mean, what about just starting from scratch and saying, you know, how do patients think the systems should get paid? And I think that's an interesting thing we're going to be looking at. So I'll just leave it with this. I think behind every story is a patient's, behind every bit of data is a patient's story and experience. We have all of these guys painting the data. You know, we have another clinician over here looking at it a little differently, and then someone down in the corner drawing a duck. And I think it's important that we remember too that we think about all of these experiences as being important contexts in the decision making, and obviously bring the patient into this process as our other speakers have talked about. And I look forward to our discussion today. Thank you.
Thank you, Ben. Where's Ben? This is a pincer movement. David Shea is being attacked by the two Bens. Right, so thank you. I want to open up the panel discussion. I want to thank all the three speakers first for your talks. They're definitely, I have a ton of questions, but I don't want to ask the questions. So I'm going to open up to the audience straight away. So does anyone have any questions for any of our three speakers? And we have microphones, if you raise your hands up. So we have Dr. Michael Scher from Wayne State. If you raise your hand.
Thanks. Good morning, everybody. I'm from Wayne State in Detroit, and this is a question really for maybe for all three of the panelists. This is a very beautiful environment, a nice room, sophisticated discussion in a top-notch academic medical center. And when I go back to work tomorrow, I'm in a very inner-city urban environment with difficulties with communications with patients with lower socioeconomic status. Often there's a white doctor talking to a black patient and an element of distrust that you have to overcome every time you walk in the room. So with each of you talking about your various experiences, I wonder how you take into account places like where I work.
Okay, well, maybe I'll start. Okay, David, please. Oh.
Yeah, sure. So I work in a community health center for at-risk adolescents in Ypsilanti, which is about 8 miles from here and somewhat of a different world. So my practice is not as tough as inner city Detroit, but it's, you know, a little bit familiar, what you're describing. And it strikes me that, and that informs the work that I do at Blue Cross and the work that I do on performance measurement and the work that we do holding providers accountable. And I feel that it's absolutely vital to first of all, account for socioeconomic status in the analytic work that's done. Without that, if you're going to be measuring performance of a doctor in Detroit or a doctor in West Bloomfield, you might as well not bother. It's manifestly unfair on its face. So that's a point. But even then, I don't think that the methods that we have to account for socioeconomic status and social determinants of health more explicitly are adequate to the challenge of risk adjusting that away. And so that's one of the reasons that I feel strongly about two things. One is, measurement at the individual practitioner level falls apart very quickly the closer you look at it. Better to measure at a population level, and then at least you have half a chance of coming out with an assessment that has some connection to reality. Secondly, measuring at a population level helps to catalyze system change at a community level, and instead of fragmenting practitioners, holding them collectively accountable begins to get them to be more collectively responsible for system change, so it's a more pro-social approach. And then finally, I do still believe that it's more important from the patient's perspective to know that the providers in your institution, as you are actively involved in a learning health system approach to continuously assessing and improving their care. That's, to me, the more important marker of quality than trying to give them data on mortality or prostatectomy outcomes or so forth, because we all know that the substrate, the patients coming into your clinics, are different fundamentally in many ways than those coming into other centers, or those coming into a tertiary center are very different from those going into a community center. And so I feel like it's important to use the data to empower providers to improve, and not nearly as important to improve the kind of technical data we tend to focus on to guide patients.
I will ask Ben Harder to go next, especially since you discussed socioeconomic status in your talk. Yeah.
So I'll give you two answers to the question. It's a really important one. One is what we do to try to even the playing field in performance measurement. And as I said, we do adjust as best we can with the limited data we have access to for socioeconomic status. We use dual eligibility, which is all that CMS makes available to us in the limited data sets we have. And I recognize that that's not an adequate proxy for socioeconomic status. We're also looking only at a Medicare population, so we're not comparing commercial to Medicaid, for example. But it's a step in an important direction, and I agree with what David Scherer said about the vital step of attempting to adjust for SES. On a different level, I would answer that by saying that, you know, U.S. News' work, as I said, is for decision support. It's for consumer decision support. And so health systems' efforts to address the underpinnings of the sociodemographic challenges in healthcare are not really the purview of our work when we are trying to help a patient make an informed, data-driven decision about which hospital or which physician to seek care from. However, we do recognize how important that is. I certainly do. And one of the side projects that I do outside of my work at U.S. News is I'm working with the GuideStar organization, which is a nonprofit data transparency platform that has compiled data on community benefit spending from hospitals. And they've been working with researchers and working internally to understand what hospitals are doing, health systems are doing to try to address the social determinants of health. That's just one example of ways that we can make sure that the right incentives are driving health systems, right intrinsic incentives. I've been very impressed at how many leaders of health systems have told me, particularly children's hospitals, have told me that they have community activities such as early literacy campaigns, which I don't think of as being part of the conventional purview of a healthcare organization. But those are the sorts of things that we see being vitally important to addressing the long-term social determinants of health. So something we want to encourage, even if it's never going to be part of our decision support for patients.
Ben Haywood, I was happy to see that you had worked with the veterans groups, for example.
Yep.
So give us some your feedback on this, especially about maybe the diversity of patients that you try to reach.
Yeah, I mean, just in terms of our platform itself, we are probably underrepresentative of minority and underserved populations overall. Interestingly, we historically have thought about our platform as having activated or more activated patients. We actually recently deployed the PAM and to measure and understand that, and we were surprised ourselves to learn that it's actually more bimodal. We have more ones and fours on the PAM, if you know it, than we thought, and we're trying to figure out when and how the ones move or not move on the platform up their activation. We have looked at our representativeness against academic medical centers, and while we are underrepresented against the general population, we are generally more representative of than clinics at larger AMCs. But I think, I would really emphasize Ben's point, I mean, the question is, if you go from the doctor level to the hospital level to the system level, the things I think we need to think about is, are we incenting the system to think about the right problems? Because I think these questions about things that are, as Ben so well put, outside the normal purview of a hospital, you know, there's a lot of money flowing into clinical care, and if we are, as a society are not thinking about the whole patient and the whole aspects of the determinants of their health, and enabling the system and the clinicians and the hospital systems to affect those, then I think we're going to have a problem, because we're going to continue to be hyper-optimizing for this small percent of care that really affects outcomes, particularly in places where there are food deserts or, you know, other challenges around getting access to good care. And I think the only challenge there is, I think, you know, the quality of care is not evenly distributed, is not necessary in this country. And the question is, are we ready to redistribute that care to the places that should be providing it, which is really taking the localization, the geographic localization out of healthcare broadly, and thinking about, hey, how can the best systems go to patients where they're at and provide the care that they're able to provide at places like this?
Scott, microphone. Yeah, there's coming up there. And if each person just introduce themselves.
I'm Scott Regan-Bogan from the University of Michigan. I wanted to ask about our obligation to make available to patients the findings of the various work that we do, in particular the clinical quality initiatives and the clinical registries. So recognizing that a big part of the conversation around the ProPublica report card was the fact that while we may have some data sources we might believe in more, we don't really make those available to patients to help with their decision making. So I'd be interested in hearing to what extent you think we have an obligation to make the data from our Michigan quality initiatives and other registries available to patients, what risk that might put on our ability to keep up the missions of those quality initiatives, and how we might approach those conflicts. Thanks.
That's a really important question. Can you hear me? What I would say is I have been a fierce advocate of public reporting, of voluntary public reporting from clinical registries. I think STS took an enormous step in commencing that now, I think, about 6 years ago. And last fall, as some of you may know, the American College of Cardiology began voluntary public reporting at the site level, which I think was an incredibly important step as well. The conversations that I've had with registry leaders over the last several years have focused on the question you raise, which is the unintended consequences. The purpose of these registries, generally speaking, is quality improvement, and we've seen and heard how important that has been for shifting the entire curve and making sure that every provider can provide better care. We don't want to impair that, and we don't want to create perverse incentives for those who participate in those registries. And so while I think public reporting is vital and it should become part of the goal of all registries, if it isn't already, we recognize that there are a number of priorities that have to be balanced. And in the case of ACC, for example, we had probably a four-year conversation with them before they began public reporting. It was something that came from their intrinsic motivation, but we were also urging them to do so and talking about how U.S. News might use it. And yet, if there isn't a good auditing system in place, or there's concern about non-comparability of the reporting within participants, it can have unintended consequences. So move toward public reporting, make it voluntary, do it as quickly as is expedient, but also recognizing that that those fundamental questions need to be carefully considered.
David, it looks like you're gunning to go ahead.
If you could stop me, I'd be surprised.
Are there untoward consequences of public reporting?
Just to
pivot back, because Ben Haywood started his talk with, well, I can't believe that we're having this discussion. Of course it's got to be available. So, David.
Yeah, so on the one hand, I instinctively get that, of course, it has to be available. On the other hand, it really is very difficult to measure to improve and measure to judge at the same time. And it's not just that there are unintended consequences, but those unintended consequences can be severe. I'm going to give you three very quick examples. So first, let's measure the performance of cardiologists. Is that an interventionalist, an EPS specialist, a heart failure specialist, an imaging specialist? Are they working solo? Are they working as a group? And so that measurement at the individual level is fraught. It simply is. If you go to the institutional level and you're measuring something like mortality, that's really important. You can divide mortality performance into quartiles, quintiles, deciles, or anyiles. And yet there tends to be, for most procedures, a hair's breadth difference between those cutoff points. And even the range tends to be extremely narrow, especially where mortality is uncommon for the procedure. And so it could be accurate data, but it can be misleading data. So I really prefer index scores, where you are compressing many indicators, performance measures, into an index score. Because for, as I said earlier, a patient doesn't care about the A1C percent performance. They care, how does the doctor do generally for diabetes? And so, by analogy at the hospital level, an index performance score allows you to see how they're doing generally without showing every single bit of technical detail, without the explanation, could be very misleading. And then the final point I want to make is we actually had a really profound example of unintended consequence and its power in a study that was done by David Brown, Mauro Moscucci. I helped by attending to syntax and grammar of the report, but it was comparing Michigan to New York State. Michigan had a CQI, and New York had public reporting. We applied the very same registry analytic tools to a comprehensive set of clinical data that was available from both states, so apples to apples, hard to do. And it turned out that the mortality rate in Michigan was 6 times the mortality rate in New York. Oh my God. Unadjusted. It was the same adjusted. And what that meant was, in human terms, the people with severe conditions with heart attacks were put on the medical ward, more likely to die there. They weren't getting angioplasty in New York State. And that's because even though the outcomes tend to be better with an intervention, it looked bad on the report because there were more deaths. And so people were getting fundamentally better care and better access to care in the state with a CQI than in the state with public reporting. And so it has to be handled with great care, not to protect information or anybody, but to do it in a way that empowers people appropriately without harming them.
Could I just point out that consequence is a failure? It's either a sign of bad risk adjustment or fine risk adjustment and a presumption of bad risk adjustment. If clinicians are concerned that the risk adjustment doesn't take account of their risk, they may, a public reporting system can have an unintended consequence, even if the risk adjustment is okay, right?
So I guess I would frame it differently. So what you just described, Dr. Scher, I think is a very important dialogue we need to have as a society. And the question is, to me, your question says, should the people be in this room be having that conversation to protect their own self-interest, or should we be having it as a society in an aggressive, open, and transparent way? And I think that's, for me, the difference, because the reality is these are hard concepts, and there will be things that go wrong. I think we have to think about one of the challenges around the do no harm mentality of physicians, and you know, obviously that's got a lot of good benefits, so I don't want to throw it completely under the bus, but is that it doesn't look at it necessarily at the right scale. And I go back, and again, I mean, this is, you know, my experience comes from my experience, but I go back to my brother who lost his life to ALS, and you know, if you think about what, let's just say transparency, and I know it's not related to this, but more in drug development, moved up the cure of ALS by 1 year. So just, you know, let's say the cure happens in 30 years, but because we go transparent, it happens in 29 years. That's 5,000 lives we save. So we have, if this conversation can save 5,000 lives. Let's think about how we're going to distribute those 5,000 lives with harm that might become from short-term unintended consequences versus long-term unintended consequences of keeping it non-transparent.
So I don't take issue with any of that, but I'm going to give you another little example. I have a relative who had back surgery, a repeat surgery, a few days ago. And she was going to see this particular expert at this particular institution in Detroit. But when it was learned that she only needed a certain amount of hardware at one level of the spine, and it didn't require a more complex redo, she didn't see that doctor. She saw one of his colleagues, because he only does the ultra complex redos, because that's his extraordinary expertise, and he concentrates on the patients who are very, very difficult. His outcomes are going to be really bad compared to somebody who takes naive patients who've never had a back surgery before. And yet, if you look at the group of surgeons, neurosurgeons, orthopedic surgeons who do that procedure at that institution, you'll see the pattern that they do very well in aggregate. But if you look at only his, you're going to think he's the worst surgeon in America. And so all I'm saying is, do it in a way that's mindful and thoughtful, involve the patient community in dialogue about what level of information is useful to them and how to do it safely, the sharing that is. And don't just sort of put it out there because, by God, you believe that public reporting is God's gift to mankind. It requires more thought than that.
And just real quick, I don't think it's just about reporting it out and throwing it out there. I mean, I do think this is about including everyone in the system and including patients deeply in the dialogue. So I think that's starting that process, and totally agree. And again, there's huge challenges of physician level reporting around, all the complications you mentioned and Ben spoke about well.
Reassuringly, STS published last year, Shaheen et al. Found that there was no evidence of risk aversion from the 4 years at the time, and I think now 6 years of their public reporting journey. So I know the literature that's come out of New York has been mixed, and I think we were early days in risk adjustment when New York began public reporting. STS seems to have gotten it right.
Doesn't the STS do it at the institution level?
They do currently, although I've heard Dave Sheehan say that they will do physician level composites at some point.
Well, we're all staring at the screen, and so a question has come up. And actually, we have, I think, like 20 questions all waiting for us. So let's see how many we can get through. So this is from Ray Tan. Ray, are you here or are you virtual? There you are, Ray. So with public reporting, what level of inaccuracy or discordance is acceptable, if any?
Well, I certainly some is bound to happen. And I think that needs to be part of the dialogue. I mean, again, I think this is a dialogue. And going back to the lean thing, I mean, we need to be able to talk about the hard questions, the hard problems with doing this right. And I think we don't need to be talking about it in a small community of health service researchers. We need to be talking about it at a society level, at a patient level, and we need to figure out, I mean, to my evidence framing, we need to figure out how to have this dialogue and work with patients to have this dialogue in a meaningful way that they're understanding, engaging, and activating in it. I think just remember that intrinsic motivation thing you talked about for physicians joining CQIs. I think they're so meaningful to being an activated patient. Purpose, autonomy, mastery, right? Patients, all they want is their disease and their experiences to have meaning, so they want purpose. They want to actually, what we need as a system is autonomous and engaged and activated patients. And lastly, mastery. One of the challenges of the healthcare system as a patient is you come with such information asymmetry, such power dynamics. As absurd going down to, you have to stand naked in front of a stranger all the time. So those power dynamics are real, and we need to think about those. I think starting the dialogue is the only way to do it.
So could I offer just a top of mind thought, which is that there are a number of for-profit entities that are in this game, and they want data out there, they want attention, they want hits, right? So that there's a self-interest there that I think is a little problematic. It would be really good if there were some standards across
this discipline where folks who report have to describe the degree of accuracy they tolerate and to highlight in, you know, red, green, yellow colors where there is strength to the data or in questionable accuracy. Another thing that would be really appealing would be when there's discrepancy or discordance across rating systems, wouldn't it be cool to have something flashing saying, you know, here are two links to other sources that say the exact opposite. So that, and they all had a certain sort of professional or, I don't know what you call it, but market obligation in some way that was standardized.
That's great. Ben, I love this question.
Ben, can I, because I want to bring this in and ask, because about hospital compare. Mm-hmm. That's public reporting.
Good,
isn't
yes.
It?
Good.
And who
good
here
angle.
Have been onto Hospital Compare website? So, how does that compare to what ProPublica did or what you are doing at US News?
Right. There was an interesting health affairs paper by Pronovost and others a couple of years ago, a year and a half ago. And I asked the authors why they didn't include the Hospital Compare ratings, and I really wish that they had, because it highlighted discordance among some of the for-profit and non-profit organizations, including US News, which is for-profit, I should remind you, but didn't look at Hospital Compare. So I hope someone will redo that study and look at discordance there. This is a great question. It's a really, really important one. And I think the points that David Scherr brought up are really important. From our report cards, we do link to STS for exactly the reason that you state. And I think it's a fantastic idea for all of us to keep in mind. We tolerate a higher level of inaccuracy than scientists generally do. And we've given this some thought, and you may disagree with our thinking on this, but let me at least share it with you. Scientists typically shrink from type 1 error, right? The debates I hear in the scientific enterprise now are, is a .05 itself too high for many applications? When you're building a foundation of knowledge one brick at a time, you can't make a false step. I think that standard is absolutely wrong for the purpose of consumer decision support. I don't disagree with it in the scientific context, but I think we need to reconsider what the patient's intentions and priorities are and how we can best serve those and how we can best convey the uncertainty that we have. My mother needs a hip replacement soon, and she lives in Boston. There are lots of hospitals, lots of surgeons who can offer that service. If I were to complete my analysis and determine that surgeon A appeared to be better than surgeon B, but I was only 80% certain, I have two choices. I can either tell her that they're statistically equivalent, or I can tell her that I think surgeon A is better, but I'm not sure. If I tell her that surgeon A is better, and I'm wrong, and she ends up going to surgeon A instead of surgeon B, I probably haven't done her harm. Because if they're equivalent, she's gotten the same care. Maybe she had to go out of network, maybe there's some financial toxicity, maybe she's inconvenienced, but I haven't exposed her to additional clinical risk. If I tell her that those two surgeons are equivalent and surgeon A was better, I've exposed her to unnecessary harm. And so for me, that drives our decision to call as many balls and strikes as we can. I think David's point is a really well taken one. We need to be clear as we can with a population of users who don't necessarily understand statistics, that we're not sure, but we do need to give them as much information as we can so they can prioritize that.
Greg, you have a question.
Yeah, Greg Offenberg from University of Michigan. Thank you all. This has been a great conversation. One of the sort of tensions I've had in listening to people who advocate for increased transparency comes from the fact that, you know, it seems the impression may be that essentially it's at worst a zero-sum game. So we're increasing transparency, and all we can do is get better. For instance, in your example of the ALS patient, so 30 years from now, 5,000 patients may be saved. What if in the process our measures are inaccurate to the point that 100 patients a year suffer? So 30 years from now, that's 3,000 patients. So now your gains are only 2,000 patients. So for both Bens, I think, how do you measure how do you deal with the fact that this is going to be an iterative process, there's a lot of imperfection along the way, and actually there can be negative consequences while we're trying to get to the perfect goal, and how do you sort of monitor yourself in the process of developing these measures.
Well, I mean, I think Ben's last answer describes a fair amount of it, and I mean, I fully aligned with his philosophy and the way they're thinking about it. I think that's important. I think, again, to that example, you know, your counterexample, well, no, most people wouldn't say, you know what, I'll do this, but it might cost us 100 patients this year. But quite frankly, as a society, that's still a net benefit, right? So that's a natural break in the system on sort of doing what I would say is the right thing, if those numbers in that hypothetical example. I mean, I think the reality, it is hypothetical. I mean, it is an incremental process. There will be mistakes, and I think that's very hard. Again, it's the do no harm mantra. The mistakes, the risk aversion is on the no mistakes, but I don't think that takes into account the long term or the societal view of the problems we're looking at. So, I'm almost religious about this, as you can tell, but like, I think if you begin to open up the process, the dialogue will happen, and those mistakes will be more rapidly fed back into it and improved. I mean, again, just random examples that don't relate to performance measures, but think about tumor boards. We've been running tumor boards in quiet, in a hospital for whatever, forever. If we had, as a society said, document your hypothesis, report back on the process, capture that data. We've just run, I don't know, 10 million cancer experiments that we have not captured, and we have no learning from as a system. I mean, my view, it's almost immoral level of not actually improving the system capture of data with a mechanism that's really effective at a micro level that societally, if we had been opening it up, it would have been, we really could affect significant change.
One way I would answer your question, although I don't know how many patients use Hospital Compare, obviously the financial penalties and incentives that CMS has created have enormous repercussions for health systems or health delivery, some for the better, maybe at least in the 30-year timeframe, some for the worse. And I think that some of the measures that they've created are really have questionable validity, even some that have been through a fairly rigorous stakeholder process. I'm all in favor of measure harmonization around valid measures, but if we let CMS decide a measure set that's going to drive enormous financial penalties and we don't have any challenge to that, any independent assessment of that, I think that could become very problematic and lead in the direction that you're describing. And so one of my goals and one of the reasons we often don't harmonize with CMS on measure definitions is that where we see an opportunity to improve the measure or at least test the stability of their measures, our work may show that there's discordance, and I think that's important for us all to know about and for us to investigate. Otherwise, we may find 30 years from now that we've been losing another 300 patients a year unnecessarily.
Can I get one more question from the Twitter world? Jim, do you have something come up for us? I think we want to stick on time, so we have a couple of more minutes before we finish. If not, I have. So how do you best integrate performance measurement into residency? How to account for outcomes data and pros in CBME? Comments about that, about residency training and performance measurement.
Well,
how does that impact us as an academic center?
Very high level. I mean, I think that, you know, I mean, I think we should be moving towards them. I mean, I think in general, we should be training that you should measure everything you do and just abstract it outside of performance measures and PROs and say, in the process of it, we need to think about, you know, performance, state change, measuring that, understanding it, intervention, and then quickly following up at the right time frame. And so I think, you know, that needs to be part of the training and thinking broadly, that we should not be providing care that we do not measure in a specific and actionable way.
David?
Well, this is another good example of the importance of measuring at a system level, whether it's for complex care in the hospital at the hospital level, or if it's a community practice-based challenge that is being examined, then broaden the scope a little bit. But It makes no sense to me to measure and report at the individual residency level in a public way, but it makes perfect sense to be continuously incorporating resident practice into measurement schemes and feedback and accountability within the institution, but then holding the institution collectively responsible for creating a system that reliably yields outcomes of high value. And so, to me, that's the right balance.
And Ben, how do you go out there on the field, you know, you see both academic and non-academic centers. How much pushback do you get from the academic centers about, well, we're a training institute and that has to be accounted in your metrics?
There is some of that. I think part of it is hoping that U.S. News can be all things to these organizations. I think the question we got about addressing the health disparities is in the same category. We're not there to measure academic productivity or training. We're there to help patients decide which hospital can do their AVR better. But we recognize it's vital to the research enterprise that that activity is suitably compensated, and I'm not sure that all of the changes in in payment reform are taking that into account. And so I don't know that I have a perfect solution, but we're aware that that's a problem, and it's not necessarily part of the patient decision support calculus, but it is part of the larger societal picture that we need to make sure that we're not creating perverse incentives for hospitals to focus on, you know, a checklist of process measures and ignore their trainees and residents.
Could I add just really briefly to that? We haven't used the phrase opportunity cost. When in cardiology, if you're going to do what can be easily done with public reporting for interventional cardiology, you might look at door-to-balloon time and mortality. But you're going to ignore many, many aspects of that procedure and its performance that really are going to have a much more meaningful impact on outcomes for patients. And so the more you train your sites on narrowly framed, credible, national harmonized measures, whether it's at a resident level or an attending level or a community practice level, and the more money is tied to that and everything is monetized and commoditized, the less people, energy and resources people will have to look much more broadly and deeply, as the CQIs do, at the totality of an area of care.
So just quickly on that point, which is a good one, the study that I flashed in my slides by David Ash it was an academic medicine paper, and they looked at obstetricians and their complication rates and attributed that back to the institutions where they'd done their residency. And they found significant variation that, adjusting for other factors, they felt they could attribute to the quality of the residency training program. And I think that's a really interesting paradigm to think about if we're looking to reward good education, good medical education and training, is can we look at these outcomes and not necessarily report them to the hospital, but report them to the institution that trained the surgeons or the doctors.
I think that's a good point to end on. It's always the resident's fault. So we've had a stimulating discussion. There's tons of questions on Twitter that we couldn't even get to. We have to end. We have to have a 10 to 15 minute break before the next session begins. But many of the concepts and themes that you've discussed just carry on throughout the day and tomorrow. And I'd just like to just end with purpose, autonomy, and mastery. So please give a round of applause to our three speakers.
I love that.